Hi guys, welcome to Animal Wonders. I'm going to start off with a question. What is your first reaction when you see this? If natural selection has done anything for you, then you should have wanted to back away quickly because you've associated this image with a horribly aversive stench. If you overcame your instincts and you reasoned out that she cannot spray you through your computer, congratulations, you win. Skunks have an awesome reputation. These warning colors are going to tell other animals, stay away, something bad will happen if you get too close. Now, most of you have probably smelled a skunk smell before, but you know, most of you probably haven't been actually sprayed by a skunk. That means someone had to tell you that stench belonged to this animal right here. This little lovely is Lollipop, and she's a striped skunk. There's actually 12 different species in the Mephitidae family. This group of stinkers used to be classified in the Mustelid family, which includes otters and badgers and ferrets, but they have recently been classified in their own family, Mephitidae. And there's five common ones: the striped skunk, the spotted skunk, the hooded skunk, the hognose skunk, and the stink badgers. All of them have a similar pattern. The black with the white stripes or broken spots. They can come in different color morphs like gray and cream or all white albino, but most of them are black and white like this. And of course, they have that awesomely nasty spray. Let's talk about that. Skunks have amazing adaptation. Their anal glands, which are located on either side of their anus there, have evolved into a specialized defense mechanism. When they're threatened, they're going to tense muscles around those glands, which are going to send a fluid 3 meters out at their predator. The fluid contains a variety of low molecular weight thiols, which structurally are like an alcohol, but have sulfur instead of oxygen. Humans and other animals have a very sensitive sense of smell towards the odor of low mass organosulfur compounds, such as thiols, thioethers, thioacetates, and disulfides. Malodorous volatile thiols are found in putrid food because they're products of degrading protein, often thanks to microbes feasting on amino acids, cysteine, and methionine. Now, it's crucial that humans are sensitive to the smell of these compounds, so we're not going to be ingesting microbes and foods that are going to make us sick or they're going to be really hard for us to digest. So humans can actually sense these compounds in concentrations of about 10 parts per billion. That's why skunks have such a nefarious reputation. All right, so I know that we all know that skunks spray, and I'm not surprised that most people stop at that thought when they think about a skunk. You know, it's a pretty potent thought. But I think that we should start exploring some other interesting facts about their characteristics and their behaviors. I'd like to start by observing her physical characteristics. We can clearly see her warning colors, but if you look closer, you can see that she has relatively small eyes, and she has really poor eyesight. Which is okay, because she uses her keen sense of smell and her acute hearing to discover the world around her. You want down there? You can see that her body is low to the ground. She has short legs, and she has plantar locomotion in her back feet. She's nice and planted, just like we walk on our feet, on all of our feet, and not up on our toes. And you can see that her front feet here, I don't know if you can see this. Look at those claws. Now we can take a step back and observe her body as a whole. She's well suited to living in dense forests, finding small prey items, and avoiding other animals. Their distinct warning colors keeping other animals at a distance. Now, skunks are mostly nocturnal, and they're going to begin their day at sunset. They're going to use their keen sense of smell to explore the world around them. And unlike most prey animals, skunks aren't going to spend a lot of their time looking and listening for potential predators. They're just going to rely on these warning colors that keep those predators away. When an animal does get too close on accident or on purpose, Lollipop is going to go into her natural instinctive defense mechanism. Now, we all know that she's packing a heck of a punch, but she's actually not going to use her spray immediately. Instead, she's going to go through a system of behavioral warnings. This is how it's going to go down. An animal comes upon Lollipop. Say it's a dog. She's going to immediately face that animal. All of her fur is going to stand on edge. She's going to put her tail up, and she's going to start stomping. Little foot stomps. Stomp, stomp, stomp. Now, this is going to warn that animal, saying, hey, I'm here. Look at me. So most animals, humans, and most animals know those warning colors, and they're gonna get out of there. Dogs, on the other hand, not so much. So dogs are kind of irrational hunters, and they're gonna get really excited by just that slight movement and the smell of the skunk. So they're gonna charge the skunk. So Lollipop, what her next move would be to hiss or growl and charge right back at that dog. Now, she's not gonna charge with her teeth or her claws. She's gonna charge at them to try and spook them away, and then pull back and look. to see if that predator's gone away, maybe throw a few stomps in there again. Now, if that still doesn't scare this animal away, and it doesn't, because again, this dog is just going to get even more riled up because of that, then some skunks, the spotted one are famous for this, they're going to do this handstand where they pull their feet up, back feet up, and they're going to stand on their front feet and they're going to show off these warning colors right here. And so that's going to be like, seriously, you didn't see that I was a skunk? And hopefully that animal at that point is going to run away. Of course, again, we're talking about a dog here, so the dog's not going to run away. So the last thing that she's going to do is she's going to turn around and she's going to raise her tail up. And she actually, one last step before they're going to get sprayed is she's going to turn and aim. Now, skunks are really, really good at aiming. If they have enough time, they can accurately shoot right at the face, and that's what they're going to aim for, right the face of that animal. If they don't have a lot of time, they can also do a fanning effect as well. Now, when you're hit by this spray, it's an oily substance, and say it gets right in your face, it's going to burn your skin, it's going to burn your eyes, it's going to make you go temporarily blind, and it'll make you so nauseous, it's probably going to make you throw up. So while you're busy stumbling around being blind, burned, and throwing up, Lollipop's going to get away with her life. Isn't that awesome? So the reason that she's going to go through all these behavioral warning signs before she actually sprays is because she can actually run out of spray. They have about 5 or 6 shots before they have to refuel, and that can take 7 to 10 days. So they don't want to use up all their spray in one go, because if an attacker comes and they don't have any spray left, that's going to seriously mess up their rib. Despite the skunk's natural ability to protect themselves, they actually have a relatively short lifespan, about 2 to 4 years in the wild, and a lot of them don't make it past the first year. Their top natural predator is the great horned owl, which is gonna swoop down with silent flight. And their high mortality rate is also due to humans. Cars, traps, poison, sport hunting, pest control, all those things, and domestic dogs. Males and females are gonna live a solitary life, except for when they come together in mating season around February. And they're gonna have their kits in May, and then those kits are going to be weaned at about 2 months old, but they'll often stay with their mother for up to a year. Now, for those of you that are gonna wanna shout out, my grandma told me to bathe in tomato juice if you get sprayed by a skunk. Seriously, has anyone actually taken a bath in tomato juice? It sounds like it'd be a lot harder than it sounds. Anyway, tomato juice isn't the way to go. What you should do is have a mixture of baking soda, hydrogen peroxide, and Dawn dish soap. This mixture actually breaks down the thiols in the oily substance, effectively making you smell less like skunk and more like human. So the next time you see a skunk, remember, there's more to them than their reputation. Behind that black and white stripes, there's a whole set of characteristics and amazing behaviors and adaptations that make these guys just a fascinating species. So Lollipop would like to go snuggle into bed now, so we're gonna go ahead and let her go on back. If you guys wanna go on an adventure every week, subscribe to our YouTube channel, and until then, if you have any questions or comments, you can find me on Twitter, Tumblr, and Facebook. Hey guys, today we have a really special person here. This is Dr. Card, and she comes and takes...
Your mama's so stinky that she walks by and the skunks get high. Your mama's so stinky she has to sneak up on bathwater. Your mama's so stinky she was playing in the sandbox and a cat walked by and buried her.